Hello, welcome everybody to this last session of the track today. Yeah, so you are tired? No. So after a long day, one session, one more session is possible, right? So impressive. So do you see the slide? Then everything is up and running. Oh, I've forgotten something. So a couple of years ago, I gave a presentation at the Java user group in Cluj. And I prepared something for myself to return safely back to Germany. And it helped, as you see. So I'm here. So I want to try it again here now, so just to return back on Sunday to Germany again. So hopefully, I don't know where to place it, maybe. So I saw some garlic. Okay, so everything prepared. Okay, so welcome again. So during the next 60 or 55 minutes, I would like to talk with you about DevOps in general and some specific tools, specifically above all Bintray and also some other tools, including the ELK stack for monitoring and Docker. And yeah, as you see, so actually from a tool words, terms, and buzzword point of view, the teaser is a bit attractive, I think. So actually, so my name is Michael Hüttermann. I'm hopefully some sort of expert in continuous delivery and DevOps and all that stuff. And for some recent time units now, I work with JFrog, the vendor for and of the tools, Bintray particularly. So actually, this talk is split into don't be confused into two major parts. So the first part is this one, so I would just quickly go through some basic and set some baseline and give you some background and context information about what I think is DevOps and where this these integrated tool chains come into this game, right? And in the second and bigger part, I would like to open the console and show you some integration stuff and yeah, actually integrate those tools based on Docker, Bintray, and so on. So maybe so the session was announced to be interactive. So maybe it's also a bit agile, the demo at least, because this night my old system crashed, and I had to build up and set up everything from scratch tonight. So the tools and all that stuff. So I'm very much looking forward how this works out. So what I learned actually is, for example, just to give you a quick teaser on that, is that the ELK stack actually does not really work on Mac, but more on this a bit later. So let's start with the first section of the first part. So in my opinion, by the way, you can read my book about DevOps for more details. In my opinion, DevOps is a mashup of different aspects. Above all, it's about shared goals and shared processes and shared tools, right? So the goals are pretty important to share them across the functions in your organization or the different teams, right? So for example, development and operations. So it can work to have something like this, to have a CTO who who introduces a new sandwich department in between development and operations, a DevOps department. This can work. I saw that it works. But normally that's not the idea, right? So DevOps is about just keeping the existing departments, development and operations, and find some shared goals in between those existing departments. So one shared goal, which is commonly used nowadays, is the cycle time. So the cycle time, you can define it. What's cycle time in your opinion, your context? But very often it is the time between, for example, you commit, you push a change into your Git repository, and exactly this specific change is deployed to production and is available both and is available to the end user for usage. That's a typical example for shared goals, which spans different functions above all development and operations. So shared goals actually have a long history. So if you, for example, consider the Agile Manifesto, there are some principles, I think 12. And the first one states that it's of highest priority to satisfy the customer through early and continuous delivery of valuable software. I think that's a very good summary of what CD, in short for continuous delivery, and DevOps is all about. So now you may ask about the first DevOps book. What's the first DevOps book? So there is, I like that you all raise your mobile phones and make pictures. That's interesting. I should do it myself soon from you. The first DevOps book, actually, it's you can define it, right? My DevOps book is 4 years old. This one is even older, right? It was written 1986, and it was written by. One second. So I must find the garlic. Ah, there it is. Okay, thank you. Yeah, so 1986. Mr. Deming suggested some a catalog of different recipes how to cope with a crisis in the US, right, some years ago. And the list includes point 9, that was break down the barriers between departments. That's really interesting. So he's not an IT guy, right? And so that's what DevOps is all about. Interesting. Now you would probably ask, who is the first DevOps expert? It's also up to your definition, right? So one candidate from my point of view is Mr. Smith. He's my personal DevOps superstar. He died a couple of years ago, unfortunately, already. So he's not attending this conference, or don't run away and search him. Who knows him? Who knows Adam Smith? Almost all of you. He's an expert from Scotland. Let's keep it as a homework for you to find out who Adam Smith is. But in a nutshell, it's important to understand that that's also my core message about DevOps. You don't have a developer who deploys to production, or a production guy who fiddles around with Maven and codes Java. No, it's just to accept different backgrounds, skills, and experiences. Having said that, now let's proceed to the shared processes. We spend the arc to the tools, right? Processes are very important, particularly to distinguish between version control system and distribution management, right? So you have version control systems such as Subversion, CVS, hopefully not CVS, Git, and where you put all your code, business code, and build scripts, tests, unit tests, and all that stuff, right? source code actually. And beside that, you have a distribution management system, hopefully, right, which holds your binaries. And that's very important to actually, to define clear dependencies, to produce those artifacts in given dependencies, and also consume those dependencies, right? What you do, for example, with Gradle or Maven. So version control systems, what I mentioned, Git, distribution management, for example, Artifactory for managing ongoing development snapshot versions, and binaries, also release artifacts. And a second example, which is covered in this session, is a bin tray, which holds and provides final release binaries. So it's all about software configuration management, right? It's not only version control, but also software configuration management to decide which artifacts do we place in version control, which artifacts do we place in Artifactory or bin tray and all that stuff. So just take it as a trigger and think about it. That's very important. And there are entire books about this topic about software configuration management, actually. What's also very important is that normally, at least in big projects, you have some sort of mesh up of different platforms and tools and languages, right? So normally you don't have one single component based on Java. You often have this, right? But normally you also have some database artifact types or PHP and other stuff. And that's the idea to find solutions and tools that support many different platforms and languages on a native way, right? And that's also a good example for Artifactory and bin tray, which can serve as a Docker registry, for example, or you can upload, download your RPM files. And so that's really important to have best of breed tools to serve as the backbone for your DevOps ecosystem and spanning the entire lifecycle, right? Starting with development and reaching out to operations. Let's proceed to the next one. That's also very important as a preparation for the tooling. That normally, that's not actually not an emergency button, emergency cancel button. It's just a button for the subject matter expert who can press it and pull it and do some cherry picking. And he can say just, okay, let's bring a version to production in an automatic fashion, right? So normally it's the complete pipeline is streamlining the changes from inception to production, mostly in an automatic way. So let's zoom in a bit deeper and trying to map this to some tools. So let's again pick up the concept of the pipeline. So the staging pipeline actually, I think normally, hopefully you have something like this, right? So you have a pipeline with your workspaces on the left side, many, many very productive developers and coders. And then you have, that's the second box, the second station, you have actually a central build system like Jenkins. And then you have higher environments, right? Acceptance tests and production and so on. And it's for DevOps, it's very crucial to build and package the binary once at the very beginning, right? And promote it and deploy it to higher environments and to bring it to usage just by configuration. That's very important and crucial. A different aspect of this one is also that the pipeline should also introduce some quality gates, right? You define some requirements for the stations. Actually, those are doors. You open it, the change opens the door and goes through it on its way to production. And yeah, so if the quality gate, the defined gate is failed, the whole pipeline is broken actually and stops, and the change does not go through to production. That's very important, and also a good example for the tools. So for example, if you integrate Jenkins with Artifactory, you can define quality gates. If a build breaks, then actually no binary is deployed to the repository manager, right? Or if some design flaws or license issues are detected by X-Ray, another product by JFrog, then also the pipeline could break. Okay, so actually now we have the Artifactory tool, which can manage ongoing development versions, both, and also final release versions of your artifacts. And yeah, so what you see here is that Artifactory is wonderfully integrated with many different builds, build tools, platforms, what I told you at the beginning, and also is very good to be integrated to build tools like Jenkins, Bamboo, and so on. So that's from my perspective, a very good example for a DevOps backbone serving all those different, what I show you at the beginning, serve every single aspect of your DevOps ecosystem. The second one is Bintray. Bintray is available as a SaaS solution. So it can host binaries for open source projects. It's for free. And actually, that's the focus of the further part of this happening here. And that's also a neat tool, in my opinion. And also, Bintray supports what you see at the top and the bottom, different platforms and tools and languages natively. So not just upload some plain text. It's also possible, right, to upload your Word document or a video or a zip file. That's possible for sure. But also having some native support for Docker, serving as a Docker registry or a Maven repository, for example, right? So with Bintray, you can completely substitute the Maven Central. So if you experience some wiki runtime issues with Maven Central, you can easily switch to Bintray to have a more stable environment. So in the middle, we have some very, very light helper tool. That's the command line interface. So it's called JFrog. That's a binary, the executable. The JFrog command line interface. And this one is a really neat tool. You can download it and direct. It's a separate product, a very small one. And having installed that is a big help to use and to manage all those tools. So you can use the tools. You can deploy, for example, deploy artifacts to both, to Artifactory and to Bintray, but you can also manage those tools. For example, creating repositories in Artifactory. So it's a very, very powerful tool. So that's it. Thank you. No. So before starting this, the interactions and the console part, here's the quick overview of the cover tools, right? So the first one are not really tools, but two books where you can find more details. And then we have some tools. So Docker, for example, that's nowadays mainstream, I think, mainstream tool, which is even supported by Microsoft. So it's a sign for a mainstream tool. Then beside that, we have what I told you, Artifactory. Please have a look on that later on. So the first task for tomorrow, for the weekend, is find out who Adam Smith is. And the second task is to find out what is Artifactory. And now we have Bintray, we have the command line interface, and finally we have the Elastic ELK stack, so Elasticsearch, this combination, Logstash and Kibana, so for the monitoring. So monitoring is also very crucial, right? So one essential part of DevOps is that You stream back your information, you're monitoring your functional and technical information from higher environments, particularly production, to the development teams. For example, with the help of the ELK stack. So you can, that's also some sort of pointer and lessons learned. So it's a mashup, right? This whole session is a mashup. I want to give you some triggers here and there. So there are different options to install those tools, for sure. Particular also, of course, the ELK stack, right? There are some native options to install them separately from scratch. And what's part of this session here today, that we can use predefined Docker images. And there are a couple of different solutions available. So my preference at the moment is this one, so the SEBP image. It's pretty powerful and convenient to use, and very well documented. One little detail issue is it does not work for a Mac. So what I said to you, I crashed my system and I moved to Mac tonight. And I found out that it was a bit, you know, surprised that it did not work on Mac. And so maybe that's the reason why production systems seldomly use the Mac OS. But anyway, I found a solution. We will see it soon. Yes, so give it a try and pick those tools as you like, right? So you must not use all tools. It's just what I said. It's a mashup. It's a zoo of different tools, a big flower and a bouquet, and you take one and what you need, and depending on your requirements. And actually, that's the idea behind it. So that's the trick to get it running on Mac. Can you see it? Yes. I have 5 seconds to tweet my picture. I didn't do it yet. Okay. So okay, so it looks like the internet connection works pretty good, also from my VirtualBox. So this is actually, by the way, Artifactory, right? But it's not part of this game, so I close it. Actually, I open a console. Make it a bit, maybe not so big, but pretty big. Is it too small or is it too big? It's okay, right? Okay, so let's start with a quick view on Bintray, right? So that's Bintray, that's a SaaS solution on the web. Actually, we can, what I told you already, deploy some packages to Bintray. We can define some versions and packages and all that stuff. So that's my name. It's a repository with packages and some versions. We don't have any version yet here in this setting, and files. So this repository is actually empty at the moment, right? So that's the baseline. Now, what do you think about? Let's publish. Let's deploy an example binary to this distribution management system, right? So we talk about binaries. We don't talk about any source code. so we can do it. Actually, for that to make it even more appealing, let's first do the following. We will use the commander interface, and now the crazy interactive part begins. And so that's an example how to use the commander interface. JFrog, that's just a binary, it's executable, right? So I can use it, and actually that's it. So if we just return, we see that. I didn't lie. It's really the truth that you can use and manage all those tools, so including Bintray and Artifactory. That's the switch, right? So that's the second parameter. We use JFrog and BT, the small form for Bintray, and you can of course call some. We skip that. Believe me, it's possible to use the streaming API, so the Firehose API, right? So that's the ST, and then we can redirect the stream we get from Bintray and put it to a shared Bintray log file, right? So the idea behind this is that this Bintray tool offers an API which provides information, runtime information. So if you do some operations on Bintray, for example, you upload something or download or anything else, the stream API gets some information and streams them back, right? And in this case, what we do, you see details a bit later. What you see is that those response is redirected to a file. Why do we do it? You will see it a bit later. So actually, let's start it and see that it didn't work because I missed my identifier on Bintray, right? That was missing. Okay, that's all. So now all operations on my named repository in Bintray are monitored and grabbed and received. Examples will be visible a bit later. So the next piece of the overall solution is that we can now start the ELK stack, right? So we want to, you expect it already, we want to visualize those operations with the ELK stack. So we need the stack actually, right? And we can of course install it heavily, or we can just prepare it and use it via Docker. And a big surprise, we just use the Docker container. Let's see what's the current situation here on the system. So we don't have any running containers, but hopefully a sleeping one, right? So that's a stopped container, the ELK container I mentioned before, the SEP image. But in the version 512, right? It's not the latest one. So that's the stack, and I would like to use it, to start it pretty easily. Okay, that's it. So of course it's not an entire Docker workshop, but actually that's so easy, right? To just start an existing Docker container and to reactivate it actually. So now we can just have a look if it's really active. And yes, it is really active. So we have the container ID and some further information. And we also see some port mappings, yeah, that we can access the parts of the overall solution, especially Kibana, the display, the web page, from the host, right? So that's the port mapping. Okay, so Kibana is, and the ELK stack in total is started. So what's missing now? The next piece we can do is that we can just keep in this console, and we what we do now is we enter this running Docker container, so let's do this and take the container ID and let's call this application inside the running container. So the container is not available. Okay, that was a typo. Exactly. Good point. And now we are inside the container and can walk around and look here and there. And we can also just see what happens this night. And what we did already twice, obviously, is that we started the log stash inside this container and also redirected the input that is the log file. Remember the log file we created at the very beginning, and output it to the Elasticsearch, right? So that's the basic idea. You have input, you have filters, and you have output. That's the idea. So we start logstash, which just listens to the input, does the filtering. We don't have any filtering here, and just performs the output. That is actually saving to Elasticsearch. So let's start it here. So surprisingly, it worked so far. Okay, so that was the next piece of the solution. So now I think everything is prepared to now just try to find out what happens if we really deploy an artifact. So let's have a look what's here. That's a random directory. And we can actually just scratch up a simple binary by, for example, creating. So part of my preparation tonight was also to learn what beer means. So I can take this one. What you see here is we have just created a very easy, simple sample. And we can now try to deploy it to Bintray. So actually, we again need the JFrog command line interface. Then we need the switch for Bintray, U for upload, right? Then, of course, the file is important so that the tool knows what to do. And then we need the coordinates of the remote target destination. That is what I've shown you, and including the version, let's say, 1.0.0. And there is a convenient feature to deploy it, but not to make it visible, right? But we can even directly trigger a publish, so that's it's visible and usable immediately. So actually, that's the command, and yeah. So that looks good. So uploaded one edge effect. Okay, so uploading can mean a lot. So uploading to where? So we again go to the Bintray application in the web, and let's see what Okay, so the first one was an older one. I can delete it. Was the wrong one, right? Okay. So, that's the timing issues when you use some virtual boxes. Okay. So that's actually the edge effect, which was successfully deployed to our distribution management. And I think you agree that it was not too difficult, right? To just create a simple file or take it from your Jenkins server and just deploy it. So now let's bridge to the monitoring solution. So we can go to this one, and even that works. Wow, that's impressive. Okay, I display the recent ones, the last 15 minutes, and what I see is a couple of different operations, right? So that's actually the marriage of all those different aspects and tools. So what we have done is we have triggered some simple operations and made them visible in ELK. So let's have a deeper look what's it all about. So what we see here is actually what it's just a string the Firehose API returns, right? So we can of course now use the powerful features of Kibana and to, for example, have a look on the time gap. So 15 minutes is not enough. So let's look at all types of upload. What do we have? We have obviously a lot of different events regarding uploads, right? The last ones is what we see here, right? It's the newly created text file which was uploaded. And we can also actually see from where it was uploaded, the IP address, for example. That's pretty neat. Also in Bintra itself, you can use a couple of different monitoring facilities. Okay, so what we see here in this overview is that, for example, we have the first one is an upload, then we have a delete. That was what I've done on the user interface, but we can also trigger it on the console. A second delete, an upload. You know, so all different operations are made visible. What we can now actually and finally add to it is, for example, we can create a small pie diagram. So it's pretty convenient to just visualize all different operations. Upload, delete. What was the third one? Download. Oops. Oh, okay. So that's a graphical representation of what we have done so far. Right, so we can play around changing some colors. Okay, so I think it was actually the end-to-end demonstration. So of course, what I said at the beginning, that's only one piece, one fragment of the overall architecture, right? So for example, if you have something like Jenkins. Then we have, so Jenkins actually is also a pretty nice DevOps backbone. We may have some pipelines or some build scripts like this one. So let's quickly navigate into this. So what's happening here is that actually what you see, just as an example, we download via curl an Artifact from Artifactory, also as a SaaS solution, Artifactory Online, download it, and afterwards we upload it via command interface to Bintray, right? So that's what's happening here. So we can start it, we can actually try it with this version, and we can now see what happens. and looks like that the Artifact in exactly this version was found in Artifactory, was downloaded, as just to give you an example, and afterwards is easily uploaded to Bintray. To summarize and to close this, of course, what I said, this is really one single aspect, right? One single part of the overall solution. So normally, you would probably have something like this, that you have, for example, an overall delivery pipeline, like this one. And so this one starts from the very beginning. That is the checkout. Of sources, doing some sanity checks, setups, unit tests, integration tests, some Puppet stuff, even database migrations, SonarQube analyzes, and then afterwards it really builds and also tests the web application which is packaged earlier in this pipeline and is provided as a Docker image. And afterwards, this Docker image is deployed to both target tools, to Artifactory, and it's pushed to Bintray as well. So that's actually one example how to broaden the scope and to give you a bigger picture of how it can look like. So actually, I think if I did not forget anything, I'm finished. So maybe that's a good second for clapping the hands. Thank you. And now we can have some questions.